I am just going to do a quick rant about the whole Batley and Spen thing quickly, by the way, because, and I know some people who I'm friends with are a bit like, just let this slide. These people are idiots. They don't represent anything. But actually, and basically, and I think this is interesting because we heard a lot over the last few years about misinformation being spread online, so-called fake news being spread online digitally and elsewhere. And I think there's actually it's an important point to talk about. The people who often talk about it style themselves as moderates, as centrists, as liberals, and they will often claim that two extremes, whether it be left or right, are responsible because they just put left and right in the same box, and that's fine, that's political analysis. And they're, for parties and ends, are pushing misinformation. Now, this week, ever since I did a documentary in Batley and Spen, in which I interviewed the Labour candidate, Kim Leadbeater, George Galloway, Andy Burnham, as well as lots of people on the ground with a range of opinions, including Joe Cox's former parliamentary researcher, a range of opinions to have an honest understanding of what was going on. I approached the Conservative parliamentary candidate. He declined. He's turned down all journalists' requests. I also actually approached the Lib Dems. They didn't get back to me either. That's up to them. But I did my job. And what I did in the case of George Galloway is interviewed him, not least about his record in supporting the Conservative Party, which he voted for after saying he'd prefer to gouge his eyes out. He voted for them on the basis of tactical voting against the SNP. He also voted for the Brexit Party, having years before said he'll be voting for Remain like anyone with any brain cells would do, and denouncing Nigel Farage for blaming all of Britain's problems on Johnny Foreigner, and then campaigned alongside Nigel Farage. Now, I just want to quickly just put a video up of George Galloway, because he is quite amusing, if anything. This is how he denounced me, and I'll explain why I'm putting this up.
I had the dubious privilege of sitting down and having tea with the loathsome Owen Jones of The Guardian this week. It wasn't the most pleasant couple of hours, although even he had to concede that, hey, I'm quite popular, actually, in the place where he was interviewing me. And I said to him, you are part of Labour's problem. In fact, quite a big part, because you have led the way. You and people like you have led the way in the anathematization of the British working class, because they don't think like you, talk like you, because they don't dress like you, because their social and cultural norms are not the same as you. You have blackguarded them.
Why is it? It's a fascinating character. Fascinating character. Don't dress like you. I mean, most people don't sit around dressed in a Federer hat. Talk like, if we're going to talk about how people talk, why does he speak like that? I've never heard anyone else enunciate in such an extraordinary way. I'm well known, of course, for demonizing the working class. My first book, of course, being entitled Chance, The Demonization of the Working Class. The point about that was, it is quite funny because he's such a ridiculous character in so many ways, is online. Because what happened was, after the interview at this cafe, brilliant cafe, by the way, if you're in Batley, do go to it. And they gave me a chai. Oh, it's the best chai I've ever had. Chef's kisses. And an iced latte. And they asked me to pose with the drinks after the interview, which I did. Turned out Galloway was in the background. They put it on their social media feed. And that's not been used to show that I posed with George Galloway. I'm a supporter of George Galloway. I'm his biggest fan, apparently. I'm a massive fan of George Galloway, who I blocked on Twitter about 6 years ago, who I regard as a charlatan, a demagogue with deeply reactionary views on a whole range of issues. Notably, recently, trans rights. He's a massive transphobe. So transphobic, you'd almost expect a newspaper to give him a column. But the point is this has been portrayed, because I interviewed him, I did my job as a journalist, that somehow I'm in cahoots with George Galloway. Now, what this shows is a lot of the people who supported Keir Starmer, not least when he departed from his promises in the leadership election, basically to be a more electable and professional version of Jeremy Corbyn, is it's all gone very wrong. It's fallen apart. He had Starmer an easy ride from the media. He's not been called a massive terrorist supporter who hates his own country. every single day. Most of the parliamentary Labour Party have given him an easy ride. They haven't tried to coup him all the time. And it's all fallen apart. And they're angry. They're upset. They're confused. Why has it all gone so wrong? You know, this guy is so electable and, you know, so obviously mainstream and all the rest of it. The British public will come flocking to him. He's clearly more competent than Boris Johnson, blah, blah, blah. And it's fallen apart. His polling, some of it is worse than Jeremy Corbyn was at this time within his leadership, even though there isn't a massive internal civil war and a massive media campaign against him. The polling is worse than Labour suffered in 2019 when they were, I think we'd all agree, routed pretty comprehensively. He's lost a seat, which Hartlepool, which Labour kept in the 2019 inferno. He's in danger of losing another seat. Two by-elections in a row, an opposition losing to the government. Again, you have to go back to 1929. I won't go into the details there, but that's not even a valid comparison. Things have gone very badly wrong, and they're angry, and they want someone to blame. They don't want to blame themselves and their politics. They don't want to blame Keir Starmer, because that would mean questioning his leadership. So instead, they're blaming people like me, who are simultaneously irrelevant, which is how they've portrayed the left, irrelevant, no one listens to them, and all the rest of it. And we also have the power to swing a by-election by doing a video in which we interview one of the candidates. Equally, and this is what I'm just going to end with, because this is far more dangerous and insidious, is what I've just alluded to, is a deliberate attempt to claim that British Muslim disillusionment with the Labour Party, as I've said, nearly 9 out of 10 Muslims voted for the Labour Party in 2019, an absolute pillar of Labour's electoral coalition. Many of them are disillusioned, like lots of non-Muslim voters are, and that's the point. Labour is not winning new voters compared to 2019, but it's actually losing existing voters who kept with them in the rout of 2019. That's not good. They're going backwards. And they're attempting to portray Muslims, as I've said, as being driven not by legitimate considerations like Palestine and Kashmir, because the people who support Keir Starmer think that foreign policy issues are fringe issues that voters do not care about. They're just eccentric obsessions of the Labour Party membership. So they can't indulge that, because that would mean conceding to a left-wing narrative. So instead, there's a narrative being built that this is homophobia and anti-Semitism. And that is why British Muslims aren't voting for the Labour Party. And what's so dangerous about that, of course, is a lot of the British media will happily go along with that because they are riddled with anti-Muslim bigotry and hatred. That is one thing which much of the British media has in common. Now, the consequences of that, for factional purposes, so-called centrists and moderates, the sensibles, the grown-ups of British politics, are prepared to throw one of the most oppressed and marginalised minorities in the country under a bus in order to protect their faction, to ensure they stay in charge of the Labour Party. And that is disgusting. It's disgusting. And those people should be driven out of British politics. The idea that you would happily whip up bigotry and hatred against the minority that is relentlessly, every day almost, hatred is whipped up against them by the British media. The idea you would indulge that narrative because you think that will protect your political faction and the leadership of your party makes you beneath the gutter, because people will be spat at in the streets, they will be bullied, and they may well be attacked as a consequence, because you will fuel this idea that British Muslims are a dangerous, bigoted enemy within, who are backward and hate Jews and gay people and all the rest of it, and that's what's driving their disillusionment. You are disgusting people. I have nothing but contempt and revulsion for you, and you should be ashamed of what you are doing, including that Labour official who briefed to the Mail on Sunday, a violently racist publication, that this was because of Muslim anti-Semitism and homophobia. I can take your lies, and they are lies. No honest person could ever suggest that I support George Galloway, a man I loathe, and vice versa. But when you try and weaponize bigotry against Muslims for your own political ends, you have vetoed any right to be accepted as someone in British politics who should be respected or treated as a legitimate political actor. You are an enemy and you will be defeated. And if it goes wrong for Labour and Batley and Spen, I would vote for Kim Leadbeater, by the way. I would vote for Labour, as I've always done under every leader in my adult life. But that's irrelevant, because Labour can't rely on people like me who will vote for Labour come what may, which I get criticised for on the left, incidentally. if it goes wrong for Labour, and if anyone tries to use this narrative against British Muslims, those people should never, ever, ever be able to get away with it. They must face the consequences of trying to throw a minority under a bus for political ends for the rest of their lives. And that's all I've got to say about it, because I am angry about it. I'm very angry about it. I'm angry about how British Muslims are demonized in the British media all the time. And I'm angry that a desperate political faction who have a leadership, which has no principles, which has collapsed in popularity, which has messed it all up, and now is looking for anyone else to blame for their own failures, those people have to take responsibility and not try and throw a minority under a bus. I've had my rant. I'm angry about it. And that's all I've got to say.